Everyone, thank you for coming out this evening. I'm Kyle Cleveland with TUJ's Institute of Contemporary Asian Studies. We have with us tonight Paul Scalise, who is a senior research fellow at the NEAS Institute of Advanced Studies at the University of Duisburg-Essen in Germany. And he's also a research fellow here at our own Institute of Contemporary Asian Studies. Paul has a PhD from the University of Oxford. He was at Tokyo University for a number of years and has been studying this area for almost 16 years. I think Paul has a different perspective than many of our speakers have had. He really is an energy policy wonk and understands those issues in a lot more nuance than often we hear them discussed. Paul's been teaching in Germany, and he teaches political science, political economy, and I think he'll have a very interesting lecture tonight. So Paul will speak for about 30 or 40 minutes, and then we'll have an extended Q&A. We ask when we do turn to the Q&A that you go to the microphone in the middle, and you can line up if you need to. So let's welcome Paul Scalise.
I'd like to thank you for coming out. I'm probably the only one in this room wearing a suit, so I'm the only one sweating except for this gentleman in the back. So I might walk around a little bit just so that the breeze hits me, which is a good thing. No, you don't want to see what's underneath this jacket.
Yes, we do.
On that note, let's start with a question. With a showing of hands, just so I get a sense for the people in the room. How many people in this room have taken a course or have read a book dealing with one of the following? Microeconomic theory. Show of hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people. 7, 8. Okay. It's lesser than I thought. Macroeconomic theory, yes, more. International trade theory, monetary theory. Okay, any economic theory whatsoever, just raise your hand. Okay, about half the audience. All right, there's a reason why I'm asking this question. About 20 years ago, I was a lowly graduate student at the Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies. That's located in Washington, D.C. Some of you might have heard of it. I was, at the time, studying international economics as well as Japan studies. Back then, it was the age where Japan was still on track to overtake the U.S. by the year 2000, if anyone can remember that far back. Dear Mr. Fingleton, where are you today? But back then, we were all fed a very steady diet of micro and macroeconomic theory, so much so that the word theory never once showed up. In other words, theory, it wasn't speculation, it was fact, it was reality, as far as we were concerned. And if people just studied more, so the argument went, there would be no ignorance in the world anymore, we would all be enlightened, and, you know, the Donald Trumps of this world would not exist. Or at least that was the argument. Now, along comes a nice little place known as Sushitaro. Now, if you've ever been here, this is one of only two Japanese restaurants in all of Washington, D.C. This is located on 17th Street. Take my advice, don't go here. The food is overpriced, it's not that good. I'm on camera saying this, lovely. But the fact is that the Johns Hopkins University always took its Japan guest speakers to Sushitaro. And one of the people we took was this gentleman, the late Chalmers Johnson, who passed away a few years ago. Chalmers Johnson was a luminary in the field. He perhaps is best known for his 1982 seminal work, Meaty and the Japanese Miracle, which I strongly suspect many people have at least read or are familiar with. Now, Johnson was reviled in that age because he said something that was considered blasphemy to any economics student at the time. He maintained that neoliberal economics taught in most American universities is the academic equivalent of Marxist-Leninism. in the former Soviet Union. Now, this is a shock to many students who studied neoliberal economic theory. But Johnson was convinced that what we learn in school about the so-called homo economicus, the economic man, where everything is rational, it's all about material self-interest, it's all about profit maximization and re-election and the individual being out for himself. He thought that was all complete and utter nonsense. And the answer to him is the same answer that we get today. If you argue these things, we were taught at university, there is obviously something wrong with you. If you don't believe in neoliberal economic theory, then you are one of four things. Number one, you're just ignorant. Rationalization, number one. Number two, you are mentally unbalanced. That was one that appeared in the newspapers more often than not. Number three, you're corrupt. In other words, you know the truth, but someone is paying you to say something differently. And number four, my personal favorite, which was used over and over again, you're a bigot. You're a racist. And if you criticize Japan's institutions, if you say that they are superior to American institutions, there's something wrong with you. You're probably racist. These are known as logical fallacies. They are ad hominem attacks. They have nothing to do whatsoever with substance. And yet, this is what we were taught. And strangely enough, in social media, you might be finding them more and more today in the realm of US and UK and maybe even Japanese political economy discussions. I bring all of this up because at the very restaurant that I just mentioned before, I was in a long conversation with Professor Johnson, and I said, why don't you just believe what everyone else believes? And he says to me, I remember as if it were yesterday, Mr. Scalise, I sincerely hope that you spend an enormous amount of time on one sector, because what you're going to come to realize is what I've realized for a long time now. Theory has nothing to do with reality. It is just that, speculation. And I hope that you do study something. Now, at the time, I was one of these people that used these arguments ad hominem as they were against him. But now, after 16 years of studying the electricity sector in cross-national context, I've struggled to come with the idea that he might have actually been right after all. And I want to talk a little bit now about the evidence, go through some of the puzzles, talk about the conventional wisdom, which is essentially interests matter. This is the conventional wisdom. You read it everywhere in journalism, newspapers, magazine. It's the underlying assumption everywhere. Interests matter. We'll talk a little bit about technological innovations, constraints, and then we'll actually deal with a new, what I would suggest, innovative hypothesis to explain the past and maybe, dare I say it, predict the future. The first conventional wisdom hypothesis is known as the public interest theory. Basically, why do we study regulation at all? And the idea is that theory should make predictions concerning who benefits from regulation, which industries are most likely to be regulated, and in what form. In other words, it's a normative theory, meaning what should happen. And since the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, it was essentially the main hypothesis as to why regulations take place in the electric power, nuclear industry. And essentially, it said this, that regulation is supplied in response to the public demand for corrections in market failure or for highly inequitable practices. That's the hypothesis. Now, in this, and every model has assumptions, the assumption is that public officials, whether we're talking about politicians or bureaucrats, they are nothing more than selfless technocrats. They don't care about themselves. They care about you. They care about me. They care about the general public. And so they want a socially optimal outcome, okay? Now, as it turns out, Chalmers Johnson was one of these advocates, and he sort of led a so-called revisionist school of thought in the United States and elsewhere on this subject. And to be fair, if we look at some of the ideas surrounding the public interest model, I suppose you could say there is some truth to it, that in the case of Japan, relative to, for example, South Korea and China in terms of carbon dioxide emissions or environmental regulations meant to help the public, it's certainly true that Japan, relative to China and Korea, has had several regulations that keep, especially when it comes to coal industry, carbon dioxide emissions at a minimum. Yes, it's true, Japan is the fifth largest emitter of carbon dioxide in the world after China, which is the first, the United States, India, and then Russia. And you can see quite clearly that the growth was exponential in the energy sector after the economic takeoff in the 1990s, including in South Korea. But even though Japan is in absolute terms quite large, in terms of growth overall, it's managed to stay rather flat. One could argue that this is part of the public interest model. Also, what you might notice as a positive side to all of this, Japan is one of the rare countries in this world that has virtually minimal blackouts and brownouts. That is to say, if you get a typhoon that comes anywhere near Tokyo, the lights rarely go out. Good luck in the United States, okay? In the United States, the lights go out even before the hurricane shows up. The lights are somehow off. I don't know how it happens. Frankly, I don't even care. All I know is that in Japan, you could be God and shaking the island and the lights won't go out. That's a rather impressive achievement for a supposedly corrupt and destabilized central power regime. So that's another tick in favor of the public interest model. However, and then there's one more, relative to countries like Germany and France and the UK, Canada, even the US, the electricity being transmitted over long wires does not get lost as much as it does in other countries. Now, these are suggestions or type ways of testing whether or not the Japanese market is okay relative to the rest of the world. But then you look at the weaknesses, something that's rather well known to most people. Japan has some of the highest electricity prices in the world. And these prices tend to be around the monopoly level. That is to say, that if you look at the OECD average for both the residential and the industrial sectors. Now, I should point this out. There are over 18 different electricity tariffs, what the Japanese call the denki ryokin. This is just an average of all 18 for the residential industrial sectors. But if you average them out, Japan is still 112% above the OECD average for residential and 144% higher than the industrial. Now, this does not bode well for the public interest model. Plus, you probably heard, especially after Fukushima, that regulations tend to be a little inconsistent for the nuclear industry relative to other countries, that they not necessarily are adopting all the appropriate regulations worldwide, and there tends to be a little weight and drag of previous institutional arrangements. These are things that are difficult to get change in terms of laws. So the new hypothesis essentially rejected the public interest model for something that you constantly see, you're reading it all the time in newspapers. Journalists love to talk about it, even if they don't use the term per se, and that's called regulatory capture. What is regulatory capture? It's the antithesis of the public interest model. Essentially, it basically says that regulation is not for the public, it's for the industry. It's all about the electricity sector. The reason regulations are there is so that the industry can be profitable. It can make money, okay? And essentially, then the legislators are captured by the nuclear industry. They are captured by the utility companies. And this is both for bureaucrats and for legislators. The hypothesis is that regulation is supplied in response to the demands of the industry to, and this is the key phrase, maximize their income. Several people would argue that we're going to assume that bureaucrats and legislators, no, they are not selfless technocrats. They don't care about you. They don't care about me. They only care about themselves. That's an assumption. And the reason they can assume this is because things like Fukushima happened. Consequently, the regulatory capture model, and this has been advocated by such people as Jeff Kingston, who is a professor here at Temple University, Kenji Kushida, and of course Kiyoshi Kurokawa, who was the chairman of the National Diet's official report on the accident, would agree that it's all about regulatory capture. What's the problem with that? Well, a lot, actually. Number one, nuclear construction costs, it is certainly true, have been rising since the 1970s. If you take a look at all of the construction costs for each and every nuclear reactor in Japan, you notice an obvious trend. Since the 1970s, they just keep getting more and more and more expensive. Now, intuitively, you would think, and this argument has been put forward with no evidence whatsoever, that the profits would also be going up or at least stay flat for the nuclear industry. Actually, the exact opposite has happened. Profits keep falling. Returns on invested capital also keep falling. They've been falling since 1985. Why? Why are the margins getting lower and lower and lower? It's actually quite easy to understand. Expenditures are rising faster than revenues. Revenues are flat, essentially, because the politics of electricity does not allow Japan's already high electricity prices to rise any further. Consequently, what happens? The utility companies, the shareholders, the stakeholders increasingly have to eat the costs. And as this result happens, the profit margins and the returns fall. And they've been falling consistently now for the past 30 years, nonstop. If you look at just the nuclear industry, and this blue line is the Japan Atomic Power Corporation, it's even more pronounced than the red line, which is the industry average. The nuclear industry, surprisingly, that no one has ever bothered to look at this, has seen its profits, its cash flow, its essential profitability eroded now since the 1980s. It's shocking, really, that very few analysts discuss this. But then we have the problem with the regulatory capture theory, which is not really a theory because it doesn't really explain how regulation came to be controlled by the industry at all. It's just assumed that they do. And why should regulation be controlled by the nuclear industry or the power companies rather than another interest group? Again, if you read closely what all of these people are saying that subscribe to the regulatory capture model, it's never discussed, not once. It's just assumed that it's true. So if profits matter and it's essential to the regulatory capture model, why does the industry tolerate profit erosion? That's a question to ask. And if it tolerates profit erosion regulations, for example, eminent domain, draconian environmental protection regulations, and this concept known as universal service, which basically says, if you want electricity anywhere in Japan, the power company by law has to get electricity to your house. Even if you live on a ridiculous island out in the middle of nowhere, the power company has to somehow get you power. That is called universal service. It is law. If you fail to do this, you are penalized. Has it happened in the past? Absolutely. Strangely enough, it doesn't get reported that often. Why? Because it's not very interesting. And yet it does actually happen. Lastly, public referenda. If the power companies are all powerful, if the nuclear industry controls us all, why are there referenda at all? Why do we care what the public thinks? It's an interesting question. No one ever bothers to talk about it. So there's actually weaknesses with the regulatory capture model. So along comes Nobel laureate George Stigler in 1971, who wants to correct all of this, in the United States at least, and he comes up with the economic theory of regulation. Once again, a speculation, not fact, but it's a speculation on how the world works. And he says, Japan, the United States, any developed industrial country's politics is a marketplace, just like economics is a marketplace. And in economics, you have suppliers and buyers, a mutually beneficial exchange. In politics, you also have suppliers and buyers. The idea is simple. Everyone is rational, everyone is out for themselves. Politicians want to get reelected. Bureaucrats are interested about career advancement, so are judges. Industries are concerned with profit maximization. Unions are concerned about higher wages. These are, the argument went, reasonable assumptions to make. And therefore, if they're reasonable assumptions to make, there's a political marketplace. I, the election-minded or re-election-minded politician, I'm going to sell my vote to the highest bidder. And you are going to buy it from me through cash contributions to political parties, through advertising, through information collection, and of course, getting out the vote to make sure that I get into office. All right? You read this constantly, even in Japanese press. It's also postulated without much theoretical and, dare I say it, rigorous empirical examination. And consequently, what bothers me is book after book after book after book after book after book starts from this assumption and writes about it, but never bothers to put all the dots together. And I find that rather strange, because if you look at the question, does money really buy public policy? Well, on the left-hand side, it's certainly true that the Liberal Democratic Party's cash contributions have been rising now since the 1970s. This comes from the Kumpel, which is the Cabinet Office's gazette, which publishes every September all the data for where all the money is coming from for all the political parties. And what you'll notice is that individual contributions, including from power company executives, are less than 4%. They're barely anything of the money that makes up the Liberal Democratic Party. And what's even more fascinating is the PAC contributions. Those are the political action committees. The Japanese call it the Seiji Katsudo Iinkai. There are all kinds of Seiji Katsudo Iinkai. The fact is they donate money, but does it really matter? The sad fact of the matter is since 1977, when in the case of the Liberal Democratic Party, the political action committees donated about 90% of all LDP revenues, it's been falling now for years and years and years. In 1993, Keidanren, which was the peak organization for business interests, they basically gave up altogether and said, we're not going to oblige you anymore to give out to donate to the Liberal Democratic Party. Screw them. They don't give us anything anyway. So let's not give them any more cash contributions. Consequently, it keeps falling. And then in 1994, something interesting happens. They decided that it was a big mistake in general for both the DPJ, the LDP, for all the political parties. So then they came up with something new. They came up with the idea of circumventing candidates and try to help parties in general. And that's when they passed the law for government subsidies of political parties, otherwise known as Seito Joseho, right? Which now, if you look at where all the money's coming from for the LDP, it's not coming from bank loans. It's not coming from publications like it does for the JCP, the Japan Communist Party, the publication Akahata, which is about 70% of their revenues come from just selling that. It doesn't come from membership dues. It doesn't come from cash contributions. It comes about 75 to 80% now are taxpayer subsidies. And the idea is simple. If the taxpayer funds the political parties, we don't have to worry about what the Bernie Sanders and Donald Trumps of the world keep saying, that politicians are beholden to cash contributions. In other words, they're corrupt. We don't have to worry about that anymore. And so that's been the problem moving forward. In Japan, it's very difficult to make the argument that politicians are corrupt and they're bought by special interests. And to underline the point even further, this study took me about 2 years. I looked at every single cash contribution for the electric power and energy sector. I looked at business assets. I looked at revenues. I looked at lobbying expenditures. I looked at memberships. I looked at government allies. I looked at everything. And I looked at a series of incidents ranging from 23 to 29 cases overall. And I wanted to see if the side with the most money, with the most resources, political resources, got what they wanted. And surprisingly, what I found is that in only about 12% of the cases, campaign cash contributions actually had much to do at all with how the policy turned out. In other words, the side which gave the most in terms of cash contributions to the political parties on the committees had won. So there's no real confirmation that this is even true. The only thing that has any real support is the idea that if a high-level government official, such as the cabinet office, promoted an idea, 75% of these 23 cases, they actually got what they wanted. But everything else, business assets down to cash contributions, there's virtually no correlation whatsoever. So the question I have to all of you is, why do we keep talking as if this is reality? It doesn't make much sense at all. And yet in newspapers, in academia, people keep blithering on about this stuff. They don't ever bother to test it. So we need to do away with these assumptions. And that's when I started thinking that maybe Chalmers Johnson had a point after all. Which brings us to this gentleman, John Maynard Keynes. He had a handy little notion. He wanted us to get rid of the idea of interests. And he wrote in the General Theory of Employment all the way back in 1936, "The ideas of economists and political philosophers, both when they are right and when they are wrong, are more powerful than is commonly understood. Indeed, the world is ruled by little else. Practical men, people such as you in this audience, believe themselves to be quite exempt from any intellectual influence, are usually the slaves of some defunct economist. And what really bothers me more than anything is what he goes on to say, which is, I am sure that the power of vested interests is vastly exaggerated compared with the gradual encroachment of ideas." And as I was reading this recently, it suddenly occurred to me that the conversation I had 20 years ago with Chalmers Johnson is suddenly starting to make sense. Because it's not about interests. It's really about ideas. We are all essentially captured or slaves to our own preconceived notions about how the world works. And if you've ever been on social media, you'll rapidly begin to learn, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or even Instagram, that there are certain walls that you cannot say certain things because it upsets people greatly. It encounters, you are encroaching on their, what's the term I was looking for? Their echo chamber, I think is the term. But even in newspapers, we're seeing this rapidly now in the United States and to a lesser extent in Japan, which is a tug of war between which is more important, interests or ideas. And I would like to propose a different way of looking at a problem. It's not looking into money. It's not looking into interests. It's not trying to determine who knows whom. None of that. It's not about who controls whom anymore. It's about ideas and information. Now, essentially, and we've known this now since the 1960s when Thomas Kuhn talked about the structure of scientific revolutions, when he talked about how even scientists all revolve and work around a paradigm of how science works and what is generally considered acceptable. It's the same for social science. It's the same for journalism. There is what is acceptable to talk about and what is not acceptable. There is taboo, and then there is legitimate discourse. Now, we see this a lot, including in Fukushima-related subjects. There is legitimate discourse, and then there are nut jobs and wackos and cranks. These are, of course, ad hominem terms. But we have a tendency in virtually any subject or issue to other or place at a distance people who do not echo what is commonly believed to be standard, legitimate, unquestionable belief. Now, if information continues to pour through from various sources to either confirm or disconfirm our essential paradigm, and for this purpose of this discussion, we're going to stick with nuclear power, a lot of serious peer-reviewed research has come to discover, Surprisingly, that images or paradigms on how we view this particular power source has changed over time. There was an award-winning study published in 1993 by two political scientists, Frank Baumgartner and Brian Jones, which showed, strangely enough, that the image of nuclear power went from positive to overwhelmingly negative over within 50 years using the Reader's Digest and the New York Times. They coded articles. They quantified and coded articles. Positive, negative, and neutral. What is a positive image of nuclear power? This is when, in the article, the journalist always discussed one of many subjects, employment, how nuclear power brought employment to cities and to rural areas. Two, atoms for peace, how nuclear power was going to lose the bakuhatsu, or the idea of nuclear weaponry from World War II, and adopt a more practical and economic energy source to help society. This was considered positive. And then there's negative. There are many negatives. Cesium in the food supply, terrorism, nuclear meltdowns, radiation, cancer. These are some of the many topics that would be discussed in newspaper that they would code as negative. And what they discovered over time is that the power, that the image of nuclear power would change rapidly over time, and that this corresponded directly with the actual output or legislative and regulatory output in Congress in the United States. Now, interestingly enough, if you were to look at Japan, this study I did myself, it took me about 12 months to do. I looked at the Mainichi Shimbun, which I considered, it's one of the five major Japanese newspapers. I consider it from an editorial perspective maybe to be neutral. It's not necessarily right-wing like Yomiuri or Sankei. It's not necessarily left-wing like Asahi. It's more in the middle. So I wanted to get a sense for the Mainichi Shimbun, how we're looking at the coverage of nuclear power in Mainichi Shimbun. And what I discovered is that if you go back to 1955 and you count the number of articles that is solely about nuclear power, what you see over time is a gradual increase in interest until, of course, you get about 4,000 articles a year published about just nuclear power issues in either Japan or abroad. And then, of course, Fukushima happens and you have this massive spike to almost 24,000 articles published in 1 year. But it gets even more interesting because then I coded the articles for an entire year with a nice little team of researchers, and this is what we found. That if you look at the percent of articles that are coded positive, the number of articles that talked solely about employment or the benefits of nuclear power in terms of national security or to the environment and so forth, they averaged about 80 to 90% in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And then, little by little, Three Mile Island happens in 1979, and of course this has an impact on the coverage in Japan about dealing with nuclear power. Then only about 70% of the articles were coded to be positive. Then of course there was Chernobyl in 1986, and there was an enormous amount of negative coverage that was reported in the Japanese press, which said, well, hold on, we're not going to just talk about positive issues of nuclear power. We're now going to talk about all the complications that we hadn't considered before going on in terms of the regulatory environment, in terms of the environment itself, in terms of what is happening to people and cancer, thyroid cancer, etc. Then between 1995 to 2007, there were a series of so-called criticality accidents in Japan, and this too started to have increasingly negative until we get to Fukushima, where, of course, it was almost overwhelmingly negative. The bottom line is this, that over time, the image, even in Japan, even in the so-called neutral Mainichi Shimbun, saw over time a deterioration or change in image. It's what Frank Baumgartner and Brian Jones would call a subsystem collapse. In other words, the dominant image held by the experts in society about what we should be talking about as a legitimate topic of discourse in the nuclear industry slowly changed over time. For right or wrong, I take no position on this. What I will say is that when I have looked into this and discussed and reviewed the literature on this subject, why does something like this happen gradually over time, whether we're talking about the United States or Spain or the UK or even Japan, where studies like this have shown over and over and over again that the image deteriorates? The argument put forward is fairly simple, and it's this. Every one of us in this room, just like every politician, every bureaucrat, every judge, is a victim of constraints. We are constrained by time, we are constrained by energy, and we are constrained by resources. And so we rely on experts to help us along, who spend an enormous amount of time on this subject. And yet, what happens in newspapers? Every single time an issue happens, whether it's a political scandal, or it's a nuclear regulatory problem, or even a death, there is files that journalists will call upon to see what everyone was talking about previously. And they basically, pardon the pun, go with the flow and what is acceptable discourse. Studies have shown this over and over again with journalists, and it applies to academics as well. You go with what is considered acceptable. Now, interestingly enough, what happens at the same time as there's a deterioration within the image of nuclear power in Japan, there's also an increase in the amount of regulations that are happening in Japan. It's these increase in regulations which have, study after study have shown, contributed to the deterioration of the profitability of the nuclear industry in this country, just as it has in the United States, where even though it raises construction costs and increases the lead times for the siting, the licensing, and the construction of power plants, it is also encumbering them. So no, I would argue that the regulatory capture theory, the public interest model, or even the economic theory of regulation don't really make much sense in the case of Japan. But we should really start increasingly looking at the issue framing and the collapse of policy monopolies, because we're going to experience this again in the case of renewable energy. Why is it that suddenly now there's an explosion of new entrants into the Japanese electricity market? The latest number is 3,283 companies. Most of them are solar companies. Before Fukushima in 2011, before they passed the feed-in tariff in 2012, there was only 48 companies in the electric power market, and they had basically 4% market share. Now, after the passing of the feed-in tariff, you have over 3,000 companies, and the market share is growing. Okay? This would have been unheard of before. And yet, if the powers that be were truly all-powerful, how is this allowed to happen at all? If the companies control the government, how is this allowed to happen? The same thing, strangely enough, with the number of laws, which just keep going up, supporting the renewable energy market in Japan. And if you do a study, which I have, will be coming out in my book, and you look at the image of renewable energy in this country, it is the mirror opposite of nuclear. In other words, no one looks at the negative side of renewable energy. Now, virtually all of the articles, not all, but virtually 90% of them, let's say, just discuss the positive images of renewable energy. And this has been contributing to the increase in laws favoring the renewable energy industry in Japan. So we're going to skip over this, and we'll just come to a quick conclusion because I see I'm out of time. I would say that the conventional wisdom suffers from multiple explanatory weaknesses. Instead of turning to the politics of interests, we should be exploring alternative decision-making models to try to understand the past and more importantly, for investors, for social scientists, and even for activists, being able to predict the future. This is important from a practical as well as a theoretical perspective. And that decision makers, whether we're talking about bureaucrats or politicians or business CEOs, are just as constrained as everyone else by time, energy, and resources in arriving at conclusions, and that the paradigms and imagery dominate, I would argue, our collective understandings of complex policy issues, where everything gets dumbed down into sound bites for public discourse. This is dangerous, in my opinion, and whoever controls the issue frame and the image of a policy, I would argue, has a good chance of controlling public policy itself. And with that, I'm at about 40 minutes, which is just about right, and I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
So if you could please go up to the microphone here and note that we are video recording this for our website.
My name is Khalil. I am Ambassador Bahrain. I'm very, very impressed by your presentation. I think you and me might be genius.
You think I'm a genius?
No, I feel.
Oh, okay, okay.
You know, there's a lot of mistrust in economics these days. As you see what's happening in the United States, you know, they blame maybe economists for what happened in 2008.
Yes.
Now, you talked about all these issues.
Yeah.
My question to you, are you saying that money have no influence on US election? Thank you, sir.
That's a good question. Let me put it to you this way. I stopped caring about what the pundits thought about political election cycles long ago, because pundits are no better at predicting the future than anyone else. They're horrible at it. And yet, the pundits kept insisting that candidates like Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders did not have any chance whatsoever because they had no money, they had no PAC contributions, they essentially had no support. In fact, they were insulting PACs in general, that they weren't going to even come close to winning the nomination. Well, as we know in the case of Donald Trump, he did win the nomination. In the case of Bernie Sanders, he came very close. Now that in itself is thought-provoking, because if money doesn't matter, what does? Can a gentleman sitting at home on his iPhone stroll into the White House just by tweeting? And there are those who would argue now that it's increasingly possible that you don't need this complex system anymore that hires pollsters. You don't need it anymore because you have the internet. You don't need large on-the-ground teams anymore because basically everyone is interlinked on social media anyway. In other words, the internet and technology have changed the dynamic so much that maybe the old rules of politics no longer apply. Now, in the case of Japan, I think it's certainly true that while you still need money in terms of support to get out the vote within a very limited period of time, the idea that money buys policy has, in the case at least of the energy sector, been borne out to be not very reliable. In fact, very few cases in which you can see that. So I guess the only short answer I can give you is I'm highly skeptical that it's even possible to make any serious argument that says that PACs control how we think and feel. At least, not anymore. Anyone else? I've managed to...
I'll short you. Well, thank you very much. Sorry. In terms of the issue frame, I'd be interested, how would you assess the role of Japanese mass media when you were studying the Mainichi Shimbun?
Yeah.
How would you assess their role in terms of defining some issues? Do they have some actual influential power in defining the issue frame or topics that are being discussed, or are they just following up on the big electricity companies?
That's a very good question. Thank you. John Campbell, whom some of you might know, is an expert on healthcare system and aging society in Japan. He wrote a book in the 1990s called How Policies Change. John also looked at the Mainichi Shimbun, and what he found was virtually the same correlation between how old age and healthcare issues in Japan changed alongside with both the coverage and the tone of the coverage within the Mainichi Shimbun. And this has been done also by another gentleman by the name of Jeff Broadbent, who looked at pollution issues in Japan. And I think the title of that book was called Environmental Politics in Japan, where he looked at a correlation, very strong in his view, between environmental activism, getting the message, the right frame, to journalists. I think at the time Jeff looked at Asahi Shimbun, and he found the same correlation. If you control the media, or you control the message in the media in Japan, you can control the policy outputs. That was essentially the argument for the Jeff Broadbent study of the environmental policy in the 1960s. It was, and I hate to do this, it was somewhat John Campbell's argument for healthcare in Japan. And in my case, for the energy sector, I think that's clear. Now, this leads to larger questions about the Fourth Estate. And are they independent thinkers, or are they influenced just like everyone else by what's happening around them? And I think there's more of a bandwagon effect that's at work here. Whereas the editorial boards, I don't think, necessarily sit down and say, we're going to take a critical stance only in certain areas and ignore others. I don't think that really happens from the journalists that I've spoken to. But at the same time, I think it's certainly true that this idea of image and what is acceptable behavior and what is an acceptable question, there's something to this in terms of the bandwagon effect in Japan. I hope that answers your question. Yes, sir.
Just to follow up, who do you think, what institution do you think should control? Because you haven't really got to that, have you?
Well, yeah, who should be in control?
You're criticizing everybody.
Yes.
With good reason.
Yes.
Well, now, what's your alternative?
Well, theoretically, it should be the people. I know it's a cop-out to say this. The voters should decide. Unfortunately, the voters are victims, like everyone else, to information processing. And to be perfectly honest, it's a circle. It's a circle. And I don't really have a firm answer on this, because my study was not intended to be a normative study on who should control the government. It was more, dare I say it, my attempt at objectivity to try to understand what is, not what should be. Maybe someone in the audience can offer a suggestion on what should be. I don't know, to be honest. Yes, ma'am.
My major is animation effect. There's nothing to do with economy.
Can you use the microphone, please?
Sorry. My major is comparative literature, and
yes.
Project about animation.
Yes.
But my paper cover about the urban theories and the precarity in Japanese society.
Yes, yes.
And in fact, I read about the book about the metaphor, and it said about, because nowadays the society become more and more like Kafka's world, like a tyranny without tyrant.
Uh-huh.
So maybe there are no any possibility that someone could get a whole picture. For example, we have the picture of the whole universe. I mean, a bit from some satellite can get a whole picture of the Earth. But we couldn't get a whole picture of the society.
Right.
No one can do that. No, everyone has his own interest.
Right.
And the city, the nature of the city covered something about the self-destruction as a process of self-renewal.
Mm-hmm.
This is totally no relationship with economics, because I'm I know a little about the economy, right. but from a culture perspective, maybe
I think there's a lot of truth to this.
Mm-hmm.
I used to avoid any subject that dealt with literary deconstructionalism simply because I am not French. I am not Michel Foucault, and I'm not going to tell you that you are being dominated and controlled by the man. I don't know who the man is. But I think it's certainly true that before the French got involved, that there was some legitimate idea in this idea of discourse. And in political science, discourse is now a legitimate topic. In fact, we now call it ideational institutionalism. We have political science, we have a name for everything. And it's this idea of ideational discourse, and it's the battle of ideas. And it's 20 years ago, nobody would talk about it in my field. Now, more and more people are talking about it. In other words, you're seeing cross-disciplinary studies between humanities departments and social science departments to get at these topics. This is a roundabout way of saying, yes, this stuff happens. I don't see anyone anytime soon in the English department getting up and saying they've discovered a model for politics, but I think there's a kernel of truth to it, yeah.
Thank you. In fact, I 2 years ago, I went to the Minamata and did a research in Minamata disease, which very similar, if you look at pattern, it's very similar to the Fukushima disasters. So I think it's a part of capitalism. It cannot get its shortage, to cover its shortage. But thank you, your
thank
opinion.
You.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
My name is Kurt Sieber, Austrian Business Council. Could you show once more the slide with the electricity loss on the grid? Okay. Yeah, here we are, yeah. Okay, do you have any data how these percentages are actually established?
These come from what is known as the Denki Jigyo Binran, otherwise known as the Handbook of Electric Power Industry in Japan.
Okay.
It's published annually by the Federation of Electric Power Companies in Japan.
Okay.
The 5.2% is the simple weighted average of each of the 10 power companies' loss on the grid system for what is known as Soden and Heiden. For Germany, Italy, France, and the rest, it's a composite that comes from the OECD, also published within the Denki Jigyo Binran.
Okay, so my question is, does the percentage of electricity loss, is it coming into any relationship with the, let's say, average distances the electricity is transported?
Well, yeah, it's, you have to...
Is there a specific...
Yes, right. You distinguish between transmission and distribution. So transmission is high voltage, long distance transmission, and that's only where the so-called electricity loss rate would be calculated. So it's over, I can't recall how many kilometers of distance has to be. I can actually look at that and get back to you if you can give me your card. But I don't, off the top of my head, I can't recall how many kilometers it calculates.
Yeah, so, okay, I'll give you my card.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
No,
off the top of my head, I don't remember.
No problem.
Yeah.
Now, how do you explain the lowest figure in Japan?
Oh, well, there's the incumbent supplier argument, and then there's the economic argument by the critics. The incumbent suppliers argue you get what you pay for. Their argument is that Japan suffers from what everyone else commonly calls NIMBY, not in my backyard activism.
And farmers, as well as almost any property owner, are very difficult to deal with. And as a result, we have to buy them off in order to get the power transmissions built in a straight line right from plant A to consumer C. And what's the quickest distance between two points? It's a straight line. So they will go over mountains if need be, rather than go around them. And if need be, they buy through eminent domain large tracts of land to get the transmission towers built. The problem with all of this, and I had a feeling someone was going to ask this, so I always bring it along just in case someone wants to talk about price. And now I'm wishing I never did this. That's for Stuart later. He'll love that. Okay. If you'll bear with me for a second.
Sure, by all means, go ahead.
This is the average electricity price in Japan starting from 1951 when the power companies were established until 2011, just at Fukushima. Between 1951 and 1973, before the oil shock, Japan's electricity prices were exactly like everyone else's in the world. In fact, they were cheaper. And then, of course, you have the 1973 oil shock, followed by the 1979 oil shock, and electricity prices go through the roof. Why? Well, everyone knows that it had very little to do with, despite what the Communist Party says, it had nothing to do with personnel costs. It had almost everything to do, at least initially, with fuel costs because they dealt too much with oil. It's about 70% or so of the market. But then the oil price fell in 1985, but electricity prices stayed relatively high. Why? Well, it has nothing to do with interest payments on debt, although they're highly leveraged companies, and it has virtually nothing to do with tax, unlike Denmark and Sweden and a lot of countries in Europe. The real reason electricity prices stayed high, and this goes back to your question, is the cost of NIMBY. In other words, what you see is an enormous amount of expenditures on capital costs in the form of depreciation, maintenance, and a notorious other category. What is in the other category, what the Japanese call sonota? It's all of this. It's all of what I call the cost of NIMBY. Getting the power lines built in a timely fashion in order to avoid the very blackouts and electricity losses that are rampant, with no exaggeration, with the rest of the world. This is a problem. And consequently, this is also back to the argument of you get what you pay for, okay? Because the power companies argue the reason electricity prices have stayed so high is because we are conducting a public service. We don't have blackouts in this country. We're protecting you. There's very limited electricity losses. And therefore, if you don't like it, go move to England. Or worse, go move to India, where the power goes out virtually every day, okay? Which is sad but true, okay? And this is one of the trade-offs. Do I necessarily agree with it? I am not an engineer, although the engineers I have asked about the transmission injuries, they kind of shruggingly agree. This is kind of what happened. So it makes sense in the financial numbers, too, that this idea of to deal with the NIMBY, we had to basically buy people off in order to get this work. And that's why it doesn't work as well in other countries, because they don't normally do this.
Well, is there not also an argument that since the pricing of electricity in Japan is based on cost, and every utility has the interest to keep the cost as high as possible because their profit margin is calculated in a percentage of the cost?
Well, if that were true, then why is the profit margin continually falling?
Okay.
That makes no sense.
Okay.
If that were true, then their operating profit margins, which are all the way at the other end of the slide, I'm beginning to hate this, keep falling, which is the reason I started this study in the first place, because the regulatory capture model kept insisting that it's all about profit maximization. But that's not possible, because the operating profit margins have continually fallen with their returns since the 1980s. And when I visited all of the companies, well before Fukushima, by the way, this has been happening for 30, 40 years, I said, are you aware of this? They said, yes. I said, what were you going to do about this? They said, nothing. Okay. I said, why? I said, because we were told, and here we go again with ideas, in natural monopoly theory, sooner or later you would have increasing returns to scale, and that sooner or later this would turn around. Sooner or later. Meanwhile, this kept happening. And nobody said anything. Why? Because if you go to a Japanese setsumeikai, they are the most boring, ridiculous, tedious events I have ever seen, where they sit there and just read the data and they pray to God everyone falls to sleep. Because no one really wants to talk about this. Okay? Nobody.
Okay. Thank you so much. I just like to add some fun for everybody. Doden and Chubu just bought my golf course in Karizawa and converted it into a solar mountain. Thank you.
Congratulations. Yes.
Sorry, can I ask a couple of things about these charts? Like for that one, the nuclear construction costs, right? Those are absolute numbers, right?
So like,
my question is effectively, if you look through time, that rises up, right? But if you go back to the 70s, effectively the plants you're building back then were probably, what, about 100 megawatts? And the latest plants were probably about 2 gigawatts, right? So have you done that adjusted for inflation and for, like, for generation output?
Because I did.
And it still rises up.
Still rises up. No change.
Okay. And then another one on the solar thing as well. It's just like the amount of new entrants, like the Tokutei Denki Jigyosha, like the new guys, right? I think you had the spike up like 3,000 or so, right?
Oh, you're talking about the new entrants?
Yeah, the new entrants, right.
Yeah.
So actually on this, have you done it, how many of those guys are actually generating electricity? Because there's a lot of people that have applied to do that, and you can see the terms of electricity have changed. But like, my guess would be 48. Those 48 are probably all generating electricity.
No.
Those 3,000, they weren't, okay. No. So what's the actual guys that connect to the grid generating and net of bankruptcies of people coming out? What's that look like?
Yeah. Okay. The very first company was Diamond Electric Power Corporation, was Mitsubishi. Okay. They sold, though. That was in 2000, March 2000 to be exact, March 23. They, even though they've been in the longest, they sell the least. Now, I went to go see the CEO and I asked him why, and he gave me a long rant about it's all Mitsubishi's fault, because the argument was that in Japan you cannot build a power plant unless you have all your customers in advance. This is the exact opposite from England and the United States, whereas if you build it, they will come. Not in Japan, you have to build it with the guarantee that everyone's going to come. Now, unfortunately, outside of the keiretsu for Mitsubishi, they didn't have many people wanting to come. This also was the problem with Enron, they found before they went bankrupt. Now, of these 48, actually, maybe around 56, only about 30% of the companies were actually selling electricity into the grid. Only about 30%. I can actually give you the names of the companies. This is before, right here, around here. Only about 30% were selling into the grid.
Okay, so that's like the steel plants are basically generating within grids.
No, those are IPPs. They're different. Okay. You have two different types. You have what are known as the special electric power suppliers. Okay, and then you have the IPPs, the independent power producers, who just for themselves, Jika Hatsuden. The Jika Hatsuden are the steel companies. Okay, and then there's everybody else. Okay. There's the ceramic companies, the beer companies. They all generated a little electric power for they had a surplus and then they sold it. Okay? Now, all of this here has absolutely nothing to do with these people at all. All of this are the people who came in after the feed-in tariff, okay, in 2012. And they saw money to be made, and these are largely foreigners, okay? And there's other people who buy up golf courses. And they hope they can connect to the grid. What they've discovered, though, is sometimes they don't connect to the grid. One interesting fact is that they stopped actually publishing around 2014, 2013, who was actually selling electricity into the market, okay, because it was getting embarrassing. The number of people were growing, number of new entrants, but the actual people capturing market share was relatively low. And the reason was because there was a lot of who came first, the chicken or the egg. They couldn't find anybody who wanted to buy their electricity.
That's an often explained reason. Okay? I'm hoping this will change, but they've discovered that you can't change this with laws unless you do what they do in the UK, and they start breaking up power companies and selling off their assets to people in order to do this. Now, the power companies argue we don't want to do that, because if you do that, then you're going to become like India, okay, where there's going to be blackouts rampant. Okay? And what do you value more, stability of supply or this? And so far, the argument has been stability of supply, so far, even after Fukushima. Now, they're going to debundle or unbundle in 2020, theoretically, and they're going to start to have what is known as an independent service provider for the transmission. Now, is that going to actually create and generate more competition to make these guys more profitable? Or should I say, well, they're already profitable with the fee tariffs, but make them even more competitive? It's unclear. Anyone else? Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Now, more serious question. Yani, if you look at economics these days, it might be very messy. Sorry to say that, this. Yani, one of important pillars of economics these days is the stock market or Wall Street.
Yes.
But if you look at it, it looks like a casino.
Of course it is.
Now, if you look at healthcare, it's quite a messy.
Yeah.
I just read recently an article. A company bought a drug company and raised the price 5,000%. Once. Now, my question is, economics was, scientists and economists were very highly respected before. Yeah. Now, we are really in a mess. My question is, many people talked about reinventing governments. And my question to you is it the time to reinvent economics? And maybe you'll be one of the leaders in this. Thank you, sir.
Well, that's actually a very nice thing of you to say. I don't want to be the leader of anything because they turn on your leaders sooner or later. And then they start throwing stones at you. But I think people like Dan Slater lost their faith in economists after 2007, 2008 financial crisis. Journalists like Dan are certainly not alone. I think it's actually one of the biggest indictments to the whole politics of expertise that very few people saw it coming. I've had this discussion with a few people who claim that they saw the Enron bankruptcy coming. In fact, I was working at a bank, Dresdner Bank. We were going to hire a U.S. utility analyst, and the question was put to him, did you know that Enron was cooking the books? And he said, oh, of course, everyone knew that Enron was cooking the books. Everybody knew. I said, you were a financial analyst covering Enron? Yes, I was. Can you show us the reports that you wrote on Enron? Oh, of course. So he sends us the reports. There is not a single thing about Enron cooking the books. It was all buy Enron. Enron has discovered a new model. Needless to say, we didn't hire this gentleman. But there is this idea that politics, or should I say punditry, is a lot of looking back and saying, oh yeah, I saw it coming. But I strongly suspect that whether we're talking about Enron bankruptcy or the financial crisis of 2007, 2008, very few people actually saw this happening. That's my strong suspicion. I haven't seen any studies of this, but just looking at what you read in newspapers at the time, almost everyone was euphoric up until the bankruptcy started to come in. That's very depressing and scary. It should scare everyone in the room, because what it suggests is that the theories and the experts which we are relying on to make informed decisions are no more attuned to what is going on than the gentleman on the street. And if that is the case, then how can we make an informed decision about anything? I don't have an answer to that, by the way. But if it's true, it should actually go to explain what's happening now in US politics, where everything is relative.
absolutely everything. And that's dangerous because there is no common agreed upon idea of what even a fact is anymore. Now it's all just an interpretation. That's dangerous, but that's where we're at now. Yes, sir.
Thomas Sullivan, Paul. You had a chart there on the money flows between the electricity sector and the government, I guess. Yeah. I was just wondering if you could comment on the Amukadari, the transfers of personnel from the regulator. Have you done any studies on that from MITI into the industry? Because if you look at the oil and gas sector, you notice there's a lot of MITI guys, you know, who are running those businesses. And even if you look at companies like Chugoku Electric Power, there are MITI people down there who are in senior management positions. So I'm just wondering if that's something you've...
I looked a little bit into Amukadari. I knew, for example, that on each board of directors of the power companies, you'll have at least one former government official that is on the board of directors for virtually all of the companies. And then in the lower ranks, you'll also see those who theoretically descend from heaven, from METI mostly. Now the question is it a sinecure? In other words, is it just a cushy job that somebody needed because at age 55 he had to get out of the bureaucracy and find work because if he didn't, his wife would divorce him? Or is it because there's value in what he has because he has connections to METI and therefore they can get their point of view across? That's the big debate that's been going on now for 20, 30 years. And there have been 7 major studies done on this. And surprise, surprise, half of them say there's no correlation with with government output, and the other half say there is correlation. So who do you believe? When you have 7 studies, they're peer-reviewed, and they say diametrically opposite things. I looked at everything but Amukadari for this particular study, simply because I could never quite figure out how you measure power for Amukadari, because I was never allowed to interview any of them, which I found rather disappointing for the power sector, number one. Number two, they always would issue arguments about privacy. They don't need to be subjected to this. And number three, everything then became an issue of connections. And I never really figured out, if you look at these studies, it's all rather abstract. So I'm afraid for the power sector, I have no real conclusion of my own to draw. I do know that people have tended for the power sector to assume that Amukadari is important for the quote unquote regulatory capture model. But I have no conclusive evidence either way on that, I'm afraid. Sorry.
What about the academic side, Paul? You find a lot of MITI people going into the universities as well who are kind of supporting the propositions that the power companies were making, Tokyo University being one case.
Yeah, this is an argument that I found interesting. Are they being... are they being bought? I was accused once of being, you know, a puppet, simply because I was one of the few people to stand up and say that, you know, bankruptcy is possible for the power companies if the reactors don't go back online. I wasn't advocating that they go back online. I was simply pointing this out. Suddenly I'm a stooge for TEPCO. As if I was getting the orders from TEPCO. My opinions were my own. And yet this happens. If you don't agree with me, you're corrupt. You're on the take. I'm afraid I don't have any real opinion on that, other than my own personal experience. Anyone else, or have I bored you all to death? Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned earlier stuff about how Chernobyl and the whole thing with the oil prices affected public opinion regarding the nuclear reactors.
Yes.
Are there any other international events that you could point at and say this might have affected what would eventually become the Fukushima disaster and all that?
Oh yeah, there are. What I've discovered is it's called the Shingikai. These are called ministerial advisory councils, And the Shingikai, as well as newspapers, have a very interesting way of constantly looking abroad to see what's happening. And they report on it incessantly. Another example that had actually a very profound impact on Japan's electric power and nuclear industry was the California crisis in 2000-2001. This was reported extensively in Japan. It was debated in the Diet extensively. It actually changed votes of the LDP, DPJ, the Communist Party, and even the Socialist Party in terms of whether there should be further reform around 2003 to 2007, to be exact. So yes, there was also the potential bankruptcy of another nuclear power company in the UK called British Energy. In 2003, it was on the verge of bankruptcy. This was reported not only extensively in Japan, but also debated. Why? Because of the issue of so-called stranded costs. That is, if you liberalize a market, but you have these expensive nuclear power plants, which cannot actually recover their costs because new entrants are using much cheaper power, like a combined cycle gas turbine, that is undercutting your price, it is very possible that without government subsidies, your company will go bankrupt. And this was one of the problems with British Energy. It was on the verge of bankruptcy in 2002, I believe. Then there's the Northeastern blackout of 2003 in the United States and Canada, also discussed massively in Japan. Once again, it's the Americans and the Canadians. Look at their system. Look how inefficient it all is. Isn't it wonderful we live in Japan and how everything is safe and clean and wonderful and the lights never go out? These are the kind of arguments that you see dumbed down in the Diet proceedings of the government, but also in the Shingikai. A lot of rhetoric, a lot of imagery, a lot of sound bites, but a lot surprisingly to do with what's happening abroad. This idea that Japan is insular and doesn't look abroad at all is a myth. They look abroad all the time. Their problem is they look abroad too much. Not that they don't look abroad enough. You should all think about that. Why don't people talk about this? Because no one ever bothers to look at the transcripts of what goes on in the government, I suspect. Now, there are some of you in this room who have argued over and over again that the biggest problem with Western journalists is that none of them read Japanese. And if they read Japanese, they would know what's going on. Well, I think there's a kernel of truth to this, at least with the transcripts. I was surprised until I started reading what is going on in terms of the constant obsession with the United States and Japan. Obsessed what the Americans are doing. Are we doing what the Americans are doing? Are we doing enough? What is acceptable in Europe? Right? It happens. Yes, sir.
Brilliant, brilliant talk, very interesting. It just strikes me that in a way you're giving a very positive view of Japan as sort of the anti-Jeff Kingston view, if I may make so bold, that actually there's much less regularly captured than one might expect looking at the facts. I'd like to, I know you were a banking analyst as well, and I was wondering isn't there a missed opportunity here in terms of you writing books? I mean, if you were writing a book about the financial crisis, which started in 2008, 2009, what would you say then about the influence of regulatory capture, of institutions giving a free being given a free ride, of the revolving door between Wall Street and the government? You know, all those ghastly Goldman Sachs bankers ending up in the U.S. government. And secondly, a slightly more philosophical point. It has struck me that since 2008, going back to your point about ideas, which I think is really important, and the fabulous quote by John Maynard Keynes, do you think there's a real intellectual vacuum at the moment, because those ideas, those neoliberal ideas, somehow are still sort of continuing in zombified form? We still have our capital markets, but as we saw in 2008, that the whole raison d'etre of the capital market is to predict risk, to predict catastrophic failure, to predict the health of financial institutions and other institutions, completely failed. And do you think, in the sense that one of the reasons there's a malaise in politics these days is because we're completely in the dark. There's no real sort of set of ideas, set of constructs which has come to replace the death of neoliberalism. But in fact, it's just continuing in zombified form.
That is a very good question. I'm afraid that my meager study is in no way capable of answering the big macro questions that you would like to have answered. If I can offer a personal opinion, I think that even if you look at Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump in the United States, these gentlemen are not the products of racist ignorance. Those ideas in various forms have been touted now for decades. Example, what some would call protectionism, others would call neo-mercantilism, which is the idea that we will protect our markets and sell abroad in order to benefit a producer-oriented society, and the wages will grow and the society will prosper. This was certainly the view of Chalmers Johnson, of James Fallows at The Atlantic, of Carol Van Wolfren, of even Clyde Prestowitz, who spoke here for, I think, maybe a month ago. He's since changed his view on that. This idea goes all the way back to Friedrich List, which was in complete antithesis to Adam Smith. The point is that it was a respectable academic subject of discourse. It wasn't based on racism or bigotry. Also, the idea of America moving out of and stop being the policeman of the world. This, too, is not a mainstream view, but it is an academic view supported by such people as MIT's Barry Posen, of Harvard's Stephen Walt, of actually a few other academics who were sadly in the minority, but it is a respectable subject to discuss, sadly, because it's Donald Trump we're talking about and his temper and questionable stability. Academics are forced to distance themselves from him. In fact, in the case of Stephen Walt, he wrote a very angry op-ed in Foreign Policy magazine 3 weeks ago saying, Donald Trump, stop stealing my ideas because I want to actually go back and teach in the classroom. The point is that whether we're talking about Islamophobia, which some would argue is not Islamophobia, it's reality, with neuroscientist Steve Harris, or if we're talking about neo-mercantilism, or if we're talking about Barry Posen's return to what some would call isolationism, these are all ideas which are respectable in academia, but are not within the mainstream. What we see in the United States, as we see in Japan, is the politics of expertise. What is the legitimate consensus view? And if you want to be a stable, acknowledged, respected individual, you go with what the consensus and the mainstream says. And the mainstream is neoliberalism still, despite what happened in 2007 and 2008. This is why Hillary Clinton keeps making speeches about the respectable view. You know who she's talking about. She's talking about Donald Trump not being respectable, not being part of the academic ivory tower ideas of what neoliberalism theoretically affords everyone in society. Now, as to your first question, I have no idea. I really don't know what I would have said in 2007. There's a great movie that discusses The Short, I think it was called, The Big Short, where there was actually a few people who did see it coming, but they were laughed at. Now, would I have put my money on the line for this? I don't think I would have. I would have been afraid to lose it all. But some people were willing to risk it. And of course, now they're celebrities for having done this. But sadly, I think they were in the very small minority, weren't they? Which just reinforces the point about the politics of expertise. And how even Alan Greenspan insisted there was nothing wrong up until the point where we started seeing bankruptcy after bankruptcy. So I really don't know how I would have reacted. But it's a good question. It's something I have to think about. We have 5 minutes left. If there's, yes, miss. The funny thing is I was expecting to have no questions at all. And there's actually questions, so thank you to all of you.
You mentioned earlier about the role of experts and that considering the perception and the role of ideas that experts also are not that much more than the common people just, but
they just have nicer titles.
Going back to your title, to the title of your presentation, like what, how the decision making and regulatory led to Fukushima. How would you answer this question, like from your title, how the regulatory and the decision making led to Fukushima?
That's a fine way to end it. I think we come back to the politics of expertise and what is considered the consensus respectable view. And at the time, the respectable view was that there was nothing wrong with nuclear power. It was safe. Now, this is strange, considering that in the chart that I had showed you, the image of nuclear power within society as a whole had been eroding for decades, right? But within Fukushima, here it is. So before 2011, it was a 50-50 toss-up within the general public. 50% thought that nuclear power was risky, and 50% thought that it was perfectly safe. But there's another chart, which I didn't have a chance to show you, which also showed the rise of NIMBYism, the rise of NIMBY activity in Japan, which correlates with this as well. Now, within the halls of power, they were still acting as if we're still up here, that there was nothing wrong. Now, within the model, part of the problem is you have this echo chamber where they were all talking to the same academics about the same issues over and over again. So consequently, when I mean that it led to Fukushima, it simply was that these examples, these anecdotes, where there was admittedly, and it was discussed over and over again, one, two, maybe three people who were scientists that said, wait a minute, maybe the tsunami protections for Fukushima are insufficient. Oh, wait a minute, maybe that GE should not have put, right, the backup generators in the basement. Maybe they should be on the hill like everywhere else. Maybe. There were people who said this, but they were drowned out by the consensus view within all of the expert panels, which said, what is the probability of this ever happening? And the answer is infinitesimally small. So you go back to the politics of image. Nuclear power was safe. There is no need to do anything. Now, that has nothing to do with the politics of interests, per se. I'm highly skeptical that it was about corrupt academics who were getting paid to say these things. I think these people honestly and genuinely believed it. But then again, within academia generally, whether we're talking about energy or we're talking about another subject, you have these trends where there are certain subjects which are acceptable to write about and certain subjects that are not. And unfortunately, the more I think about it, it's not limited to one or two countries. I think it's a pervasive worldwide concept problem. So when I talk about the politics of image, I'm talking also about the politics of consensus. And consensus does not mean unanimity, where everybody agrees. You'll always find some outlier. But you do have a consensus. And that's, unfortunately, what led to Fukushima. They didn't listen to the one, two, three people who stood up and said, this is dangerous.
Paul, I apologize for using the bully pulpit here to ask a question. But you make a distinction here between vested interest and the politics of image.
Right.
As though this, you know, maybe is a mutually exclusive dichotomy. Is it possible that image, political rhetorics are a form of interest? I mean, and let me just elaborate on that. If you look at not only TEPCO, but any corporate interest, their public relations profile and how they're perceived by the public has a huge impact upon their credibility, their public support, specifically in this regard, whether or not nuclear reactors might be restarted, and who would bear the burden of the cost of the Fukushima nuclear disaster, the government, TEPCO, the public. And so I guess what I'm wanting to kind of push on here is that distinction between whether or not vested interests might be more broadly conceived to include what you're calling the politics of interest, And are you really saying that economic and political interests are not a driving force in politics?
Basically, it comes down to, and forgive the jargon, are ideas endogenous to the interests, or are they exogenous? In other words, do they control you, or are they being used by interests? Because if you argue they are endogenous, then you're saying that interests and perceptions of one's interests have more drive or causal probability in determining outcomes than if you were to argue that ideas are exogenous or they're the sole independent variable, I'm sorry to be so technical with a technical jargon, driving the forces. I tend to think they're exogenous, okay? I don't deny at all that vested interests, that there are some interests, there are lobbyists. I don't deny any of this. They exist. But if lobbyists and interest groups and money and votes and membership and assets were truly what was driving all of this, then in the energy sector, just as with healthcare and with environmental protection, et cetera, these issues would not have gotten any sway, any hearing whatsoever. I think it would have been enormously difficult. But they did get sway. They did get a hearing. The general public did shift its mind on these issues. Deregulation also did occur, even though the power companies, which supposedly are so powerful that they supposedly control the government and did not want electricity deregulation to take place, it happened anyway. And this is the problem. If interests control or have captured the government, why do things that are antithetical to the interests of these groups happen at all? And you're not going to find the answer by reading left-wing or right-wing propaganda on the subject, which is equally bad. Or you're not going to find it also in reading economic studies, which have the same tired explanations. They look into the past, and if it's already happened, they say, oh, well, naturally it had something to do with interests of, and I'll just pick an actor here somewhere, it's this guy, and he was responsible. It's always backwards looking. It's never forward looking. And that's the problem I'm trying to express, that there is no predictive power to any of these theories because they have been utterly incapable of predicting change. Each and every time, whether we're looking at restructuring, or we're looking at Fukushima, or we're looking at the feed-in tariff, which people were claiming was never going to happen in Japan, it happened. Or the rise of renewable energy, which people kept insisting was never going to happen in this country, lo and behold, it happened. I think, seriously, there's a lot to this argument, which I have struggled with and have come kicking and screaming to accept, that ideas matter. They do. Now, how much they matter in the total gestalt, I don't know yet. It's a work in progress. But I think, seriously, we need to consider it more. And whether we're looking at social media, or academia, or newspapers, okay, ideas, I think, are increasingly getting attention abroad, and they should start having it being discussed here in Japan. Because I think Japanese are just as human as everyone else.
Well, with that comment, I think we'll close. Thank you very much.